My first slide here is a very blank map that you see, which hopefully you can at least vaguely make out, is Greenwich Village and the East Village. As you can see, there's nothing on other than the streets. This is what a map of the historic district designations of this area, Greenwich Village, would have looked like in early 1965, when the landmarks law was just passed. In other words, there were no historic districts, there were no landmark designations. We're going to take a look at how that map changed over the years. So this is a current map of that same area showing just historic districts. And as you can see, it's a pretty dramatic change in terms of the amount of area that's covered by landmark designation. That green thing in the sort of upper middle right is Union Square, so that tells you where 14th Street is. That sort of square-shaped green thing in the middle of the map is Washington Square Park. So let's go back to first to 1969, which is when the Greenwich Village Historic District was designated. So that thing with the big, huge star, that's the Greenwich Village Historic District. So that was really a giant leap forward. The three little stars that you see are the three historic districts which preceded the Greenwich Village Historic District. And they actually moved from left to right in that map. We'll go through them, but basically before the Greenwich Village Historic District, the city was really only going to look at very, very small, very homogenous districts. Then they made this great leap forward with the Greenwich Village Historic District, but there was a lot that they left out in terms of geography. As you can see, there's a lot of neighborhood that's not in there. And there was a lot that they left out in terms of the kinds of history and architecture that they felt was worthy of protection. And it's really been the work over the last 50 years, and especially this organization since it's founded in 1980, to expand those protections and to expand that recognition to both include a greater geography and to include a broader array of narratives, types of history, types of buildings, and we'll talk about what those are. So this is a slightly more detailed map of historic district and landmark protections. The stuff in orange is the historic districts. The stuff in sort of magenta is individual landmarks. That's the technical term for it. Sometimes it's actually several buildings, but they're designated all together. We're going to go through this map and see how it became what it is today. So in 1965, the very, very first, and I'm not sure if you can sort of see it, this is such a tiny building, but at the lower right-hand corner of the map, there's a little blue line, that's the Merchant's House Museum. In 1965, that was the very first designated landmark in this area, and it was one of the handful of the very first designated landmarks anywhere in New York City. So unusual about it was that it was also an interior landmark as well as an exterior landmark. So the outside of the house, which is typically what is protected by landmark designation, was landmark. They've also landmarked the interior as well, which is very rare. There's about 35,000 properties in New York City that are landmarked. There's only 150 or so that are interior landmarks, so it's much rarer. In that same batch of designations, we have the Stuyvesant Fish House on Stuyvesant Street, which dates to what, about 1804. So as you can see, there's a bit of a pattern here. The city was looking at these, you know, beautifully preserved individual houses. So this also happened on the very first day of landmark designation, along with the four remaining houses of Colony Row on Lafayette Street. There were originally nine. Five of them were demolished around the turn of the last century. Then the public theater, also in 1965, was designated, which was actually threatened with demolition. So this was considered, you know, a great work of architecture with this sort of great pedigree in terms of its history. It was built this point, these are all of the buildings that are landmarked in all of our neighborhoods, these individual monuments. Now we're up to about 1965, about 66, maybe 67. This is the Skirmer building on Lafayette Street, built by, designed by Henry J. Hardenberg, who's considered one of New York's great architects and designed the Coca, as well as the Plaza Hotel. And now we have our very first historic ever was landmarked on Bleecker Street in NoHo. This is now a couple of years later. This is the old German dispensary and the public library on 2nd Avenue in the East Village. And then in 1984, so again, we're moving very quickly through time here compared to what was happening in the 1960s, there's a very, very small extension of the St. Mark's Historic District. Just two houses, which as you can see are little, charming 19th century houses, but they weren't similar enough to the couple of dozen houses that were in the historic district. They weren't similar enough to have been included in the 1969 district. So the neighborhood had a fight for 15 years to get these two extra houses added to the district, which gives you a sense of kind of how they thought about things. This is also in the mid-1980s. This bank on the corner of 14th Street and 80th Avenue was landmarked. 1988, so we put forward a proposal for landmark designation of the meatpacking district, which at that point was just starting to change dramatically. This is starting in 2000, we began on this effort. For a variety of reasons, it changed. It was suddenly featured on Sex and the City. Bill Hotley, who owned half of the properties in the neighborhood, died and didn't have a will, so it wasn't clear what was going to happen to all of those properties. We staged many demonstrations in the neighborhood, calling attention to the danger that it faced. We worked with meatpackers, club owners, elected officials, restaurateurs, and we finally got it in 2003, the very first new landmark district in Greenwich Village since 1969. 112 buildings is about 70% of what we're trying to get landmarked in the meatpacking district.
Building on three blocks.
more interesting shifts started to take place in terms of cultural history. So this is Webster Hall, which we had been pushing for landmark designation for quite some time. And in 2008, the Landmarks Preservation Commission designated it. Now, arguably, this is an architecturally interesting building, but the history that's connected to it is really about the countercultural political movements, the radical wasn't considered important enough to marry. finally, in 2010, that first phase of it was designated as the second ever extension of the Greenwich Village historic district. And it centers around the intersection of Winkler and Carmine Street, where Our Lady of Pompeii Church is. And you can see it's these beautiful streetscapes, largely of tenements built for working class New Yorkers in the 19th and early 20th centuries. Definitely some old houses there, but more modest ones. The one at the bottom, by the way, was the inspiration for Edward Hopper's painting Early Sunday Morning. And those row houses on the upper left, one on the right, was the studio of Jackson Pollock in the 1940s. So then from there, we still continued to make some more progress on the Greenwich Village waterfront front and getting West Bethlehem, which is actually a complex of 13 buildings that are interconnected, but it's considered a single individual landmark. And that was a big, big lift for the city in a lot of ways and really important for us. Shortly after that, in 2011, the old Macy's Annex. I don't know how many people know this, but Macy's was originally located on 14th Street, and this was the Annex of Macy's on 14th Street, just east of 6th Avenue. That was landmarked in 2011. This building here on 13th Street between 3rd and 4th Avenues was built around the turn of the last century, and from 1975 to 2006, it was the studio of artist Frank Stella. Before that, in the 1940s, it was a training center. It was an assembly line training center for women during World War II. And what it was originally built as was something called a horse auction mart. So this was the place where the Vanderbilts, the Delanos, came to look at horses being paraded around. And they would look at them and they'd say, I like the way that one trots. I'll take that one. So there was a big golden ring in the middle, and they would come and select the horses that they wanted to buy. So then following that, the second phase, and this was sort of the mother load of our South Village effort happened. This is in 2013, and this is the South Village Historic District. This is to this day the largest extension of landmark protections in Greenwich Village since the 1969 designation. It covers about 13 blocks, all south of Washington Square, about 250 buildings, and among them, there's two distinctive elements of this area. One is the Italian-American heritage and the immigrant heritage that we mentioned before. The other is that this was really the epicenter of the counterculture in New York from the 1920s through the 1960s. Probably a few corners are more emblematic of that than this one here, a corner of Bleecker and McDougal, where Cafe Roi was located, and still is located where the Net Tavern is. One of the things that was great about it was we actually had to fight very hard to get several NYU buildings included in the landmark district, which were originally left out. This is one of them, the Orpheum Center, which all things considered is one of NYU's more sensitively designed buildings, sensitively scaled, sort of a modern adaptation to the environment around it. And even more sort of sensitive was the full block which originally was not included in the district. We proposed it, but the city didn't include it. We knew that without landmark designation, something terrible, terrible could happen here on this whole block site south of Washington Square. We'll get to that more in a moment. It was also a very sensitively designed building, and in fact, the community in the 1940s fought very hard to force NYU to come up with this architectural design, which was not what they were inclined towards. And here you can just see, it's really a sort of living museum of tenement architecture from the late 19th and early 20th century. These are exactly the buildings that in 1969, when they tried to draw those little 12 little district boundary lines for the Greenwich Village Historic District, they wanted to keep out. And we were saying, no, these are important too. It's a different history, but it's a different kind of architecture, but it's a very important one, including things like this. This is reform housing, so this was housing that was built in the late 19th century to be a more humane place for immigrants and poor folks to live. These 7-story walk-up tenements this stuff shows what could have happened on the site of the NYU Vanderbilt Hall. We did a zoning analysis and realized that NYU could build a 300-foot tall building on that site under the existing zoning without landmark designation. And I have to say, I have no doubts that eventually they would if landmark designation wasn't there to keep them from doing it. So that was really a challenge. Here's a couple of other important leaps forward. So in 2015, after a three-year campaign, a year-and-a-half campaign, rather, by Village Preservation, the stone wall in was landmarked. And believe it or not, up to this point, there was no designated landmark in New York City that was designated because of LGBT history. Of course, if you're going to do that, the place to start is with the stone wall in. Now, the stone wall was located within the Greenwich Village Historic District, but when it was designated,
market,
one of the very few surviving building structures in this part of town, also landmarked in 2006. So this is by far most of University Place, Broadway, 3rd and 4th Avenues, even 5th Avenue, north of 12th Street, all non-landmarks. Here's some of the amazing buildings that are in there that right now are actively campaigning for landmark designation, which is particularly necessary because of the city's approval last year.
Which is hat chopped off.
kind of suspect and unheard of. It wasn't done. If you had money, you lived in a house. It was only starting to become a thing where it was considered acceptable for people of means to live in apartments, and it was something that was thought of as being imported from the more sophisticated French. So they were all French flats, and to try to make this French flat particularly appealing, they dressed it up with all these different French motifs, including a statue of Joan of Arc over the entryway on 14th Street. Again, if you're just willing to look above the sort of ticky-tacky ground floor, it's there. And then St. Bernard's Church on the western end of 14th Street, a really, really beautiful building built to serve Irish dock workers in the mid to late 19th century. So it's got a really rich and wonderful history. So we made a lot of progress. We've still got a lot to do. It definitely took a lot of effort, both in terms of activism and organizing, as well as reframing and rethinking what it is that's important and worthy of preservation to get the district expanded and to get things that weren't landmarked in the 1960s, landmarked over the last 50 years. But we're hoping to see more progress.
Cajoling her, I would say, is a nice way of putting it, about her. makes you think she's going to all of a sudden go the right way?
So, look, in terms of why she did it, I'm not going to speak for her or represent her. And I'm not being coy about it. She didn't make that case.
So, why was I saying, did she ever say anything?
Yeah. Basically, she said two things. She said, well, I got everything that I could, and, you know, this, I think, qualifies for what you wanted. You know, she, we asked her about a star district that included about 193 buildings. We knew more. We knew we were going to get 193. The solid comps in the store district that we were asking for was actually about 195 buildings. We got 173 in the end. We're like, that's great. Job done. We're happy. So it's not like we expected everything. What she got us was 7 buildings out of 193. That is 3.6%. And they were all buildings that were not endangered and were never going to be endangered. They were the biggest, most overbuilt buildings in that area that probably couldn't be demolished with a nuclear bomb. So that was part of it. And the other thing that she said was, well, there were all of these important services that the tech power could provide, and that was very important to me. It's a valid point. However, what's very important to know and to remember is those services, first of all, could have been provided on site through a tech hub that didn't involve the upzoning that the city gave them, which is what's creating the additional increased pressure. And the tech hub, first of all, the tech hub, 3 of its 21 floors is going to be the good stuff. The other 18 floors is purely market-rate commercial space. Nothing public benefit-y at all about it. The 3 floors that the public is getting is less than what was originally proposed and less than what was proposed by other people who submitted bids for the site but didn't get it, who in some cases weren't donors to the mayor like the ones who were picked. So you connect the dots. And in terms of, look, I can't see inside Councilmember Rivera's heart to know what she wants, doesn't want. All I can do is push her as much as possible to do what I think is the right way or the thing that needs to be done. And whether she does it for the right reasons or the wrong reasons, at the end of the day, I don't care. I just want her to do it, and hopefully she will. What's that? Any other questions? Yes. So I don't believe that there are that we know yet who's going to be in the tech hub building other than those 3 floors of the sort of public stuff. But in this area, this Broadway University Place corridor that we're so worried about, where a huge amount of the development is being driven by tech-related businesses, Facebook's here we go. Facebook is here already. Building that's going up where the San Diego Sanus was is probably going to be a glass office tower. It's probably going to be filled with tech-related development. Just to the north at 809 Broadway, where Black Billiards was, it's a big new black sort of monolithic office building that went up there. That's almost all tech-related businesses as well. So this area has become ground zero for the tech boom in New York City. I'm not here to make the argument that tech isn't important and jobs are important. There are good places for big new office building development, and there are places that are not.